muted. I'm going to record this, and then Christian's going to join us. So we got a lot of stuff to talk about. We've got some Instagram. We've got some LinkedIn changes. Facebook made a purchase this week. We've got two cool apps, but let me talk to you about our guest tonight, the amazing, the talented Mr. Nick Jaworski. Nick is from, Nick's from Wisconsin. So we'll be talking some cheese tonight, maybe some beers. It's hard to say, but we're going to talk about social media mostly. So Nick works with, behavioral groups that need help, right? The addiction, recovery, stuff like that. The underserved people that really need this stuff. And we're really glad that Nick serves those people because he does a great job. Everybody needs help. I mean, of some sort of another. I read a quote today that was really interesting to me. It said that everyone is healing from things they don't speak about. It really made me think actually about you, Nick, and the great work you do. So thanks for joining us, man. How's it going?
Thanks, Bill. I really appreciate it. Yeah, man, it's going good. You know, just rocking out here at 10 o'clock.
Yeah, buddy, right? So you're in Indianapolis now, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's right. Yeah.
Cool. So what the heck, what took you to Indianapolis, man? Is it the beer, the cheese, the chicks? What's going on, man? Why would you leave the wonderful state of Wisconsin?
Yeah, that's a good question. Well, I think we've talked before. So I left Wisconsin back after I finished university. I traveled the world for 10 years. I said, I'm getting the hell out. I'm going to travel the world. So I hit a bunch of places, Prague, Turkey, Vietnam, China. I used to work in schools, did school management, that kind of thing. So came back to the U.S., worked in Chicago, continued the education gigs, and then actually got hired by KinderCare, which is one of the biggest providers of early childhood education in the U.S. by a large margin. And so I used to flip schools. They had a lot of problems. Things weren't going well. They would call me in. I'd fix it. And so KinderCare called me down here. Came out, fixed their school. They were an awful organization, decided to get out of it. And I started my marketing company. So that's kind of the long and short of it.
Cool. Awesome. And Christian joined us. So, hey, Christian, what's going on, man? Oh, and he dropped out. So, all right. So maybe it's just me and you. So, Christian, for those of you following along with the amazing Christian Karasevich's journey tonight, he would have been coming to us live, and he was with us for about 8 seconds there. I saw him pop in. He's in frickin' Bali. So he's on the other side of the world from Nick and I. I'm in Tampa. Nick is in Indianapolis, and Christian is in Bali. We're hoping to see some elephants. It's raining in Bali, which tells me he likely doesn't have much internet, which kind of sucks, right? So, but we're going to do what we can to keep him on the show. It'll be interesting. So it looks like he might be back, which is cool. So Christian, what's up, Jack?
What's going on, man? How you doing?
There we go. Good. There we go. So you're in Bali, huh, brother?
I am, yes, on a little bit of a vacation.
You are such a slacker, dude. You're such a slacker. So we haven't seen each other for a couple weeks, and now we've got Nick. So the show's almost over, Christian. So thanks for joining us. It's been real, man.
Hey, Nick, how you doing?
Hey, man. Good to see you.
Good to see you as well.
So, yeah. So new format. So I guess this makes me the host, Christian. So that means, does that mean it's
dealer's
choice? Holy crap, right? So everybody watching this should be really afraid because normally this doesn't happen, right? So that's interesting. So we're using Zoom tonight, Zoom webinar. So for those of you who watch usually and you see us on VLive, if you're listening in, if you're watching live, unfortunately, I can't see your comments. I promise you I'm not ignoring you. Zoom doesn't allow that. But the cool thing is that VLive does. So whenever we can, we're going to use VLive. But tonight, it was important to us to make sure that we had Nick here because Nick has got great stuff to share. He's got a great way of looking at social media, very, very positive, very interesting way. So Nick, before we get really started here, buddy, I gave you a little bit of an intro. Give me a little bit more of why the heck Nick does what he does and why you matter to the world. Cause there's so many reasons, man. And I just want you to brag on yourself a little bit. You do really good stuff, bro.
Sure. I really appreciate that. You know, I love what you do. I follow you all the time. Super positive, which is great. You know, on social media, you don't always see that. A lot of complainers or a lot of whiners, right? So yeah. Very, very happy to be, you know, have you on my Facebook feed all the time. And we chat, you know, off and on. So I love it. Okay, kind of a little bit of background on me. I started a marketing company about 3 years ago called Circle Social Inc. Started off just, you know, in my house, like a lot of people do, doing blog posts for like $10 a pop, crazy stuff. And then slowly built the company, or quickly, I guess, built the company since it's only been, you know, not even 3 years yet. So we got a small team of six, but we work primarily with addiction treatment and behavioral health clinics across the US and the UK. And we do a lot of crazy stuff, a lot of very technical stuff, a lot of deep data analytic dives, a lot of strategy. When I first got into the space, what was real interesting to me is I'm like, man, there's all this competition. I see all these people starting digital marketing agencies, tons of them out there. This is really hard. What I found out is it was not, because people are not very good at it. They're one, not good at getting ROI. So they don't know how to use social media to actually drive bottom line goals, whether that's getting nonprofit donations or getting sales for an existing business. So that was a big thing for us. And then a lot of marketing agencies are very fluff. They're not very strategic. So I fortunately have a very strong background in building businesses. That was kind of what I did for years, was came into a school, saw what was wrong, fixed it, flipped it, got it on track. And so a lot of the businesses that we work with, we are very strategic in what we do. So we're not really just marketing. We're almost operational partners. And that has allowed us to be very successful, I think, compared to other marketing agencies. And then over time, we got very specific into the addiction treatment behavioral health space because of a personal passion of mine. It's a very complicated space. There's a lot of very bad players in it, very bad marketing agencies, and a lot of very good operators in terms of clinical treatment, but they're great at the clinical. They don't know how to run a business. They don't know how to market. They don't know how to do sales. So that was a very good fit for us. So we were able to help these people connect with good operators, good clinicians, you know, for these people that need addiction treatment, behavioral health services. And then we're able to help the clinics run a better business so that they can actually have the cash flow to help more people. So it's kind of a win for everybody. So that's a quick background on me.
That's great, man. I appreciate that background. That's good, good stuff. So now we're going to talk about, you know, we're going to talk about This Week in Social. We've got four to start with. So Christian, you're kind of invisible, dude. So what's, are you here or are you, there we go. He's back. So
I am here. Yes.
All right. So it's, so you want me to pick, or you want to pick where you want to start, bud? Cause I'm kind of hosting.
I would say pick where you want to start. Okay. I would say, you know, first I want to say, Nick, you know, it's fantastic hearing your story there. And I like what you mentioned about, you know, how businesses or people start a business and they really don't know what they're doing. And that's the thing. The barrier to entry is so low nowadays that yeah. What a lot of people are doing is they're starting it and saying, hey, you know, I'm going to, like, you know, they think they're going to, like, anybody can build a website, you know, anybody can put together a social media profile. A lot of people use a lot of tactics they shouldn't be doing, such as, you know, buying fans and followers or acquiring them, you know, in the wrong way. And they're not really getting the right customers through the door, basically. You know, and so then, you know, a lot of people I notice they take that and they end up trying to then, you know, sell others on, well, hey, you should work with me because I have this huge audience, you know, when they really, you know, they need to just do some research. I mean, most of these people that start a business, they have no background, for instance, running social media. In a lot of cases, they haven't worked for big companies. It's not easy, you know? So, I love hearing your story, you know, like, as you mentioned, a lot of people complain on social and, you know, it's a good platform to be able to, you know, get your message across. But I think at the same time, as you mentioned, I mean, you have to like, it's almost like building a house. Like you go look at, you know, you buy a house and you want to go like, you know, you want to make sure the house is sound, you know, that the foundation is, you know, really solid. You know, the place might need some work, you know, to bring it up to code and whatnot. So it's something, it's the same thing with the business. You have to put the effort into the business to get it working properly. So I really am glad to have me on the show this week.
Yeah, I appreciate that. You know, the biggest mistake I see a lot of small business owners make when they first enter the space is they look for their magic formulas, right? Even the big businesses do that actually, but they're looking for a magic formula. They're like, oh, there's this funnel that I can put into place, you know, and that will suddenly get me magical lead faucets to turn on. You know, all that stuff is a lot of BS, right? There's no magical formula. Building a business is about creating value and building trust with potential audiences. When you deliver on that value, when you create that trust, you build the business. You know, so that's why fake followers don't work, right? Because you have no trust and you deliver no value.
Exactly. So, Phil, where do you want to start, by the way?
Well, let's, you know, I think we should start probably with something that's fairly, fairly innocuous, and that is the issue that's affecting the Instagram account. So let me share screen, and we talk about this here. So Instagram is, you know, people are having some issues accessing it. So for whatever reason, some people are getting some notifications that they can't log in. Right. And they're telling us now we need a stronger password, revoke access to third parties. I'm just wondering, hey, Nick, have you seen any of your clients seen this, or have you seen this personally?
You know, we haven't actually. We only manage a couple Instagram profiles just because it's so difficult. We need so much live content, and a lot of clients are just not equipped to actually deliver that. So we're pretty minimal in what we do there. However, this kind of issue is constant with us for originally signing into Instagram accounts, and then Twitter is a huge hassle all the time too. So we're trying to manage someone else's account, but I'm logging in from maybe across the country or across the world, and it blocks us, right, all the time. And so this is good because it's got that added security there to not let people steal your account. But it's a huge hassle as an agency, and especially for businesses trying to operate and give people user access. So like Facebook has an amazing platform. AdWords has amazing platforms where you can manage everything from a single account. Instagram and Twitter really do not yet, and that's problematic.
That's interesting. So Christian, what about you, man? Have you run into this at all?
I run into this all the time, actually. I have quite a few articles that I've written on Instagram, and a lot of people are always – And it's one of those things that surprises me. I'm so surprised at the fact that, you know, people contact me and say, hey, I'm trying to, you know, I got this message on Instagram telling me I need to secure my account, but hey, I used a dummy email address, or I used, or, you know, they used a, you know, a spam email address or something, and then they don't have the password. So I'm glad to see that Instagram's doing this. I think this is part of, you know, again, you have to remember Facebook and Instagram and WhatsApp are all owned by Facebook. So, you know, you have to remember that Instagram, you know, Facebook knows that a lot of their traction is, or a lot of people are moving from Facebook to Instagram. And so they want to make the platform, you know, they want to make sure that they don't want to happen to Facebook to also happen to Instagram, because Instagram is the direction everything is trending right now. So I see this a lot with clients. I think that, you know, the key thing is pretty simple. You know, as Nick mentioned, you're across the country, or you have somebody managing your accounts across the world. Facebook, you know, they did this last week with the show, with their updates. And those updates are, you know, for example, if you're a page manager, if you're adminning a page, you have to now go through a more strict authentication process in the US. They're moving that, you know, same process to Instagram. In this case, it's a little different how they're doing it. But I'd say, you know, just basically just, you know, secure your account properly. I mean, be careful what third-party tools you use. Not every app is approved by Instagram, for instance. Actually, most apps are not approved by Instagram. They have a very strict API process. So I think this is a really good move by Instagram as a business. I realize it creates a few challenges, but you know, you kind of have to, like, you know, it's not hard to, for instance, message, you know, somebody, a client you work with, and say, hey, I need to secure your account, or I need to do this. It shows that you as a, you know, if you're a digital marketing agency, it shows that you are being, you know, being very just proactive. At the same time, what it does is it also shows that people, you know, that you care about them. So I think that that's a good move.
But is it though? I mean, so here's the thing. You're in Bali, right? Do you get text messages to your phone from the US?
I get some of them, yes. But it also comes down to how you have your numbers set up. I mean, if you have your numbers set up, you know, like when you change a SIM card, for instance, it does ask you, do you want to change the primary number you're using?
Yeah. So. But like in Canada, though, you can't sign up most of these texts to, you know, these texts to sign up. And I'm just curious, right? This two-factor authentication, while it's great for security, could be a big pain in the butt if you have someone overseas that's managing your stuff there, Mr. Karasevich.
Actually, it's funny you mention that, because I got an email the other day, or it was talking about a study, and it actually said that most tech people, like any of the top tech industry people, they aren't even using two-factor authentication to secure their accounts, because it's very much a hassle. Yes. So.
Cool.
Here's the thing. I think you kind of have to make do with what's going on. I haven't had any of them pop up yet.
Okay.
But I also would say, if you're going to do something like this, maybe have a backup phone number for your business, like a Google Voice number or something that you could use, that you can at least get the text messages from. That way, if you use your regular number, it doesn't always work. depending on where you're at. Yeah. Based on the carrier.
Good points. Any last words there, Nick?
No, I think you hit it spot on. You know, I used to have that issue when I was living abroad. They used to do a lot of text authentication for accessing your bank account, and maybe you changed your number, or maybe the number didn't work in a different country or whatever, and it was an absolute nightmare. So there's got to be a balance between securing the account, but also somehow being able to deal with this kind of cross-border issue.
Cool.
I will say I'm sort of surprised that they haven't come up with a better method to do this, because – like, for example, you know, as you mentioned, I mean, people travel all the time, and people are traveling more and more these days because they can be abroad, they can be wherever they want and still be managing their business. And I find it's a process that, like, I'm like, did you even think about this when you started this process? Because chances are you travel a lot. So, you know, I definitely think there needs to be some changes, or, you know, have some things to almost like, you know, how you go out of a country and, like, you know, you call your bank or credit card and say, hey, I'm going to be out of the country and, you know, for such and such amount of time. Maybe have something like that set up, that same kind of process that would improve it.
Right. Yeah. Call Instagram. Right. Yeah. Good luck with that. Is that 1-900 mix a lot? Is that what the number is? Or is it 867-5309? I always get the two confused, Christian. Which one is it?
Maybe it could be a setting in your Instagram account, for instance.
Sure.
To make it easy for you to say, hey, you know, I'm going to be out.
If you can log in again, though, but here's the thing, right? I want to outsource my stuff to the lowest possible cost that can do the best possible job.
Right.
That they may not have, right? I mean, that's the challenge. And my guess is that part of this is to get people on the platform using it. Right? That's my guess. Because we know that bots... and by bots, I don't mean just robots, but human bots are doing some nefarious things. And they're often not based in Indianapolis and Tampa, Florida. Just saying, right? So that's, I'm just saying, right, that could be part of that as well. And I always think, right, what's the money motive here? Follow the money and you find the truth. And that's my guess. Right? That's my guess. Third-party apps, they're blocking those down because you don't stay on platform, right? Logging in from somewhere overseas, typically not an American company. Man, you know, sometimes they do, but then they'd use a VPN, right? And they'd find other ways to make that work. Just saying.
And I will, I think you make some great points. I will say VPN, a lot of companies are also starting to block VPN overseas as well. You know, and it, I think it's actually more of a because it's got a GPS in the chip.
Yep.
I think what they're doing is they're able to block it, for instance, on mobile, but not on desktop because there's no GPS that they can use to get that data. But, you know, I think you make some good points. So hopefully Instagram, I like the idea of it, but I think they need to work out the process.
Yeah, absolutely. Good stuff. So cool. So let's talk about the second one, talking about Instagram. Instagram announces on Twitter. This always cracks me up when companies do this. They announce on Twitter. So there's no even, they don't put it on their blog. They upload it on Twitter. They don't even put, they put the video on Twitter, which is really funny, right? Now you can send a poll privately in direct, which I think is interesting. So I don't know if you all got to hear that, but I got to hear that crap. So that's really loud. But anyway, so that kind of scares me. So we're just going to leave it there. But now we can, you know, now we can send that. So let me mute that tab because that's going to hurt my ears a lot. So we'll just let this play in the background with the pretty girl there that's going to add a poll, right? This is.
By the way, I have a question for you. So you just did a neat little tip here, something to maybe share with viewers. So you muted your audio. How did you, do you have a keyboard shortcut you use there, or what'd you do?
You just right click in Chrome and you can unmute the tab.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
So that's a good saving tip. You're going to have the little speaker icon there, but if you want to mute it, right click and mute tab. Fantastic.
Yeah. Oh, thanks. Yeah. Good call. I didn't think about that, right? Sometimes the simplest stuff are the best tips. So I'm a simple guy, so I share simple stuff. So, so this is interesting, right? You can send a poll privately in direct. So I could say, yo, Nick Jaworski, what up, dog? What do you think about my new shirt? And you can say, 100% or what's the other side? Like a turd or something? What? I don't understand. Right. So what do you think, Nick? Are you going to use this? And will you respond to the many polls that I begin to send you starting tomorrow?
Yeah, probably not. You know, I mean, it's an option. I think polling can be useful. You get low, you know, small response rates, but whatever. It's one more place to run a poll. And so where are you building your audience? That's where you want to be polling people. Facebook has it. I don't want to use SurveyMonkey. Great, do it on Instagram. So it's fine. That's about my feeling.
Yeah, fine. I'm with you. Pretty lame, but possibly cool and right. Super annoying because, Christian, stand by, dude. I got a poll coming your way. Go ahead.
I will say, I think that this is a good feature for being able to survey your audience. You know, as Nick mentioned, I mean, SurveyMonkey, that's a tool that a lot of people have used before. You know, it got to be paid because you wanted to be able to have some additional features to gather feedback. You can also use Google Forms. You can also use Facebook Messenger, as you know, I think they have this feature now. You can run polls on your Facebook page. You can now do this in Instagram stories. You can now do it in Instagram Direct. I think it's a good, again, I think that as a business, if you can gather feedback from your customers, you know, you should be doing this with every single touch point you have. For example, if I'm talking to somebody, maybe I'm gathering some personal feedback from them, you know, that can help me run the business better. If I'm sending out a package, maybe I include a survey. So I think that these are all useful. I think on Instagram, I don't get into the direct message part very much. I think that it's, you know, again, you have too many messages. Like, some of your customers are on Messenger. Some of them are emailing you. Some of them are on Instagram. Some of them are sending you Twitter direct messages, you know, and like, regardless of how much you tell somebody, hey, this is the one platform I want to be on, they're going to communicate with you where they want to communicate with you from, you know, as Nick mentioned, whichever platform they necessarily are on. So I think that this is a great tool for feedback to be able to, you know, get people that aren't interested in being public with their feedback, because some things you don't want to have public during a, you know, in a poll, for instance. Some people might be ashamed of answering it like that. So I think this is a very useful tool for a business to be able to solicit that feedback. But it's also, again, another feedback tool. So you almost need to, you know, aggregate all of your feedback that you're collecting, depending on whichever platform it is. And then, you know, maybe once a month or whatever, once a week, go through all of this. It's another thing for a business to do.
That's interesting. Well, here's my challenge with direct. How many people can you poll? How fast can you poll them? Can you blast it to all your followers, right? How is this going to be used for spam? And my question would be, I would bet at some point then you use those polls for remarketing, retargeting, re-advertising, right? So, ooh, look at that. I want to hit all the people that responded yes to the poll. I want to hit all the people that didn't respond to my poll. I want to vote all the people that voted turd to my poll, right? I want to collect that data. And my guess is it just becomes yet one more, not just feedback mechanism, but advertising mechanism. Because remember, again, as you've said 100 times, Christian,
follow the money,
1,000 more, right? So follow the money, and it's Facebook, which means advertising is that's their ching. That's where they make their money. So I don't know, Nick, any last thoughts on this one before we move to the next one, buddy?
Phil, I think that's an excellent point. You know, I would love to actually see retargeting based off of logic like that. You know, they don't have it right now. And so I wonder if that's something in the pipeline. But that's a really good point that I even think of. You're right. Yeah. So answer this, particular market, message. Nice.
I think that makes a lot of sense. I think the one thing I'd be concerned with as a user would be, you know, nothing is private, basically. And granted, you know, yes, like, you know, everything we do nowadays, somebody can screenshot it and whatnot. But I think that the idea of being able to send what I think is a private message and then all of a sudden getting retargeted to me, it's a really good, I think it's a smart idea. Fantastic idea, Phil. But I also am like, you know, it's so creepy. Like, oh, I take a poll and all of a sudden I'm getting retargeted based on a reaction, you know, down to that such a, you know, minuscule level there that I gave for the poll.
But that's super relevant though, man.
Right.
I want relevant ads. I love relevant ads, man. When John Fluvog shoes follow me around the internet and then eventually their price goes down $80 and I buy them because they're now $139 instead of $219, I'm a happy Phil, man. I want relevancy. And if I could answer a survey and maybe get a pair of Fluvogs for free sometime, right? That, you know, surprise and delight. And holy crap, like, because they do that in the bottom of their boxes. You got to look through their boxes. I just learned this last week. they give away a free pair of shoes every 100 or so boxes. I didn't know that. Now that I know that, I love Flubog even more. So if they surveyed me, I'd be like, holy crap, this is awesome. So I don't know.
I think it's a great idea. I mean, I'd love to be able to retarget based on, you know, the reaction somebody gave me in a direct message. Because again, it's about getting to, as Nick mentioned earlier also, like it's about getting to what the customer wants. Like if the customer, for instance, you know, and in this case, it's like, it's so silly because it's an easy poll for them to answer. They don't have to think too much on it. Maybe you have to do some more probing on the customer, you know, to get more in-depth responses from them, but it does at least give you something to start with. You know, for example, if somebody, and this is one thing with surveys, you can run surveys and if something is like negative towards something, well, then you know, that gives you a path, essentially a choose your own adventure, you know, path to be able to, you know, work towards. So if somebody's negative, you know, hey, I need to correct things on my, towards my business, or I need to fix something. Yeah. So, you know, I think it gives you a very clear, like, idea about what, you know, well, what direction is the customer leaning? Like, that's a pretty clear sign if they say, you know, 100% no to something. So,
yeah. Good points. I also think they're going to come up with logic that says, if they pick this, then four slides later, show this ad. If right. they pick that, show this one, right? I mean, you want to talk about choose your own adventure, man. Now it's chosen your own adventure. That, I think that's coming. So be ready for
I
that.
So.
Yeah.
I mean, I would love it.
Yeah. Well, and again, as a consumer, right? As a business, it's harder because, you know, if we're talking B2B, this is longer term. But for real, yellow kicks or blue kicks? Which one do I want, mm-hmm. right? Gary V, perfect example, man. Gary's new shoes did okay, but his first two did way better. Why is that? If he'd have polled users and found out, oh, they don't like the white laces, they want black laces, or they want blue laces, or whatever. Right now, you can on the fly do stuff, and with just in time printing and inventory, man, I can immediately see which T-shirt to sell, which pair of shoes to sell. Mm-hmm. Holy crap, right? And which one is going to get more advertising directly to the right person?
Yep,
and that makes a lot of sense. A lot of sense. Go ahead, Nick.
Yeah, and I was just going to say, I mean, it's basically what we already do, right? I mean, if I push an ad campaign out there and people click on it, you've raised your hand and said you're interested in X, right? Mm-hmm. And I think it was Tim Ferriss, right, that ran split testing on AdWords for the 4-hour work week.
Yep.
Split tested a whole bunch of different titles, and the 4-hour work week had like a 3 times higher click-through rate, so that's what he named the book.
Mm-hmm.
You know? Yeah. So, I mean, we do it already. This is just a simpler way of doing it.
Yep, absolutely.
And imagine...
Go ahead, Christian. Sorry.
I was going to say, and imagine now, like, tying this into a chatbot of sorts, you know, also to be able to, like, you know, maybe somebody answers a poll and that's stored in, you know, CRM data. Then you could, you know, for instance, have a chatbot that, you know, that doesn't have to, like, say, well, hold on, let me let the person make the decision. Let me, like, review all the data. Let me analyze it real quickly for you and give you, you know, oh, this person likes, like you mentioned, you know, yellow laces, black laces, white laces, whatever. And hey, they were this size, you know, like you have a lot of things that you can quickly tap into if done right. So I'm excited about the possibilities.
Yep. Hyper relevance, baby. Hyper relevance coming soon to Instagram near you. So two more quick things. The next one is actually right in line with that. And this is, it's clear that Facebook knew what they were doing. Not that they never, ever don't. I'm actually amazed at their acquisitions. Vidpresso basically is now making video interactive. So now they talk, now we're going to pull in video. Hey, which way do you want to go? True, choose your own adventure videos, cut your own stuff up. Imagine Instagram Live where it prompts you, right? And you can pay like a YouTube Red to skip those ads here in Social Chefs, right? So if you want to skip our ad in Social Chatter, you can PayPal us, you can send Christian money. He's over in Bali, whatever you want, or just go to socialchefs.com/daily and get our email with all of our catch up. But what's interesting here about Facebook and this purchase of Vidpresso is this is stuff they're already running on. Look, there's a poll right there. Right? Who should be paired with Phil Mickelson? Mine, Tiger Woods. Let's be clear, Tiger and Phil. Right? But here we go. This is really interesting. This has got some stuff that, you know, that's really going to make Facebook and I'm sure Instagram even cooler because they bought the people and aren't shuttering the company, which tells me you go off and be creative, but we want all your tech. right? That's mm-hmm. what I think they're doing, right? Shut down your agency in another direction, but we want your tech. So I don't know, Nick, are you, have you used VidPresso before? Is this something you're comfortable or familiar with at all?
I have not. No, it's completely new to me, but I absolutely love the move towards interactivity, right? That's where everything's moving. I mean, if you think about now, if I'm watching Game of Thrones, you're going to pop on Twitter and you're going to have a conversation about the episode as you're watching it, right? That's already happening across platforms. So now Facebook's being smart. Facebook wants to create their walled garden so that you never have to leave the platform, right? That's mm-hmm. the goal. And so the more that they bring that in, and that's why I'm so bullish on Facebook. Like, they are smart. They know what they're doing. They know where the trends are and where they need to go to keep people on Facebook. They will do it. And it's great. It's a better experience. So, you know, win-win for everybody.
Yeah, I agree. I think they're going to do like, you know, like Twitter should have done years ago. And we talked about this, right? Put the video here and watch those comments scroll like on a Facebook Live, man. That's totally it. And imagine, especially with esports, where they can pivot more quickly, right? Traditional sports, not so much, right? Bill Belichick is not going to put me in as the tight end just because Nick Jaworski posts that, right? But somebody else will. Right. On esports, they might do that just because they want ratings, because they might get paid based on views. So that's an interesting move for that as well. We're looking at, you know, Twitch visits. Right. I think Gary's got a Twitch channel. Right. That's interesting that way. I don't know. Christian, what are you thinking about this one, buddy?
I like the idea that Facebook is adding this. I mean, as Nick mentioned, Facebook is like, I'm bullish on Facebook as well. A lot of people, they're like, you know, they're saying like, oh, you know, they most of their revenue from mobile and they're all ad-based. Here's the thing. If the ads are relevant and they're trying to move customers in the direction, or users in the direction of running more ads, and if they give you the ability to target your customers, like, and get more, you know, better information to be able to get the right products that sell more, the more success that you have, the more that Facebook's going to succeed. So I think this is a great move. They have to keep adding the platform. They've got the cash to be able to do this. I'm sure this was like, you know, a little bit of pocket change here to acquire this company. Makes a lot of sense. And here's the thing, like, they can't, you know, kind of as we all talked about earlier with Instagram and third-party apps, Facebook wants to control their platform. So they don't want, you know, third-party tools to be able to have features that they don't offer. Now, granted, you know, I wish I could, for instance, I wish this was a Facebook Live that I was running directly through Facebook Live instead of using Zoom or, you know, Be Live. But they're adding the features. They need to add them and integrate them and make them very seamless for people to be able to use. And as I mentioned, you could already run polls through Facebook pages. Why not add the ability to do it in live video? It just makes a lot of sense.
Awesome. Awesome. Any last thoughts here, Nick?
Well, something I would add that I always love is, you know, as you build it into the platform, that means that, like you're saying, for advertising, you can build analytics directly on that too, right? So, I mean, it's very easy to run an algorithm that checks the sentiment of comments coming off it, you know, and so in real time, as someone running a live video, if I can have a tool on my side that says, oh, I'm getting tons of positive feedback, this is great, keep mm-hmm. going, or I'm getting a lot of, you know, smiley faces and negative keywords, and so my yeah. tool is showing me that, oh, I'm going in the wrong direction, I need to switch gears. And then I always love, think about that in politics, right? Let's say I'm a politician running a Facebook Live. In real time, I can see the sentiment of my audience and like pivot my conversation. Like the potential yeah. is amazing.
Yeah. It's like the TV show Bull, right? They use some stuff there that's kind of cool. So politicians, boy, like they need to be any more manipulative, Nick. Right. Thanks, man. So right. we could go down that rabbit hole, but we'll just stay away from that. So, but yeah, I think that's totally interesting, man. Totally interesting. And let's pivot to something that's near and dear to my heart, and that's LinkedIn. Yay! Woo! They're finally going to relaunch groups inside the app, and they're going to launch it so that it actually looks better. But boo, they're taking away the ability to actually send messages to the group. So they're saying, yep, okay, it's going to be a notification. So all the good stuff that Facebook did in groups, LinkedIn has decided that, hey, we shouldn't allow any of that, but we're going to put it back in the native app. So all the people like me that have been whining that groups is dying, they're going to put it on, you know, I think this is like an artificial heart. This isn't really bringing it back, but we'll see what happens. My hope is that they have that somehow it connects in a CRM, you know, you can already target groups for advertising, mm-hmm. which that's
great.
That's great, right? Great. So that's yeah. one of the reasons why they have to bring groups back, right? They have to bring this back. So I think this is really, really interesting. You know, this one talks about how we can pin posts and stuff as an admin, which I think is cool. I don't know. I love LinkedIn. I mean, like, you guys are bullish on Facebook. My platform of choice, because I'm a B2B sales and marketing guy, is mm-hmm. always LinkedIn. It's the most expensive to advertise on.
Yeah.
It's the yeah. easiest for human beings to connect with each other on. Unfortunately, that means the easiest to spam on. But we'll see what happens with groups. So, Nick, are you said you advertise in groups. Talk to me about your yeah. groups usage, and are you excited about this?
I love this. So we get an 8% CTR on our group nice. Advertising. Yeah. Yeah. Insane.
For those who are listening, we got some newbies. What's a CTR?
Click-through rate.
Thank you.
So 8% click-through rate is fantastic. Like, if I get like a 1 or 2% click-through rate on initial campaigns, I'm super happy. So with LinkedIn, with the group targeting, we've gotten as high as 8%. Now, the thing that sucks is I'm still paying like $5 a click. So I can go get like a 1% CTR in Facebook and pay 30 cents a click. And then I still go to LinkedIn, rock it, and they're still charging me through the nose. So.
But isn't it more relevant, though? I mean,
yeah,
you're a more relevant click. Don't you? I mean, if I've got a $50,000 product, I'm happy to spend $7, $10, $20 to get right. a real click through for that okay. somebody that's really interested instead of Facebook, which I really think marketers click on most Facebook ads. I don't think anybody else does.
Well, we do a lot of custom audiences built in. So we pull our LinkedIn audiences and yeah. we upload into Facebook, right? So we get the sure. same exact audience for a sixth the price.
Well, so, okay. Yeah. And which is good, right? But I am certainly not on Facebook to read the latest white paper on SaaS products.
Right.
I
mean,
right. On, right? I'm looking for, you know, cat pictures. Pictures of where the hell is Christian? That's my new favorite website. That's a .org now, just if you're wondering. And then what's Nick up to? That's all I'm doing on Facebook, right?
Right, so right.
I'm with you. You do reach the audience cheaper, but at the same time, I don't yeah. know that you really reach them, right?
Where's the mindset? It.
Yeah, the yeah. mindset, right? I don't know. Yep. So Christian, what about you, buddy? Are you jacked about this, or are you just excited because I'm excited?
I will say, I think, as you mentioned just a second ago, like, you know, you basically are giving yourself a smaller target to hit, but you have the right audience on that target, you know, instead of Facebook, like you're hitting, you know, just pretty much everywhere and hoping that those people are relevant. I think that, you know, the ability, I've been saying this for a long time. I love the idea that LinkedIn is finally starting to move things along. For the longest time, it just felt stale. You know, they've done a big redesign. You know, now they're finally adding some features that you're like, why did you not add these before? Because everyone else has had them for years. And now, hey, groups on, like, when I was previously with a B2B company, we were using groups a lot. But the challenge was, you know, you could manage them from mobile. You know, it was really hard for people to be able to use them because they, you know, they were getting flooded with spam, like, you know, with messages and whatnot. So I'm glad that LinkedIn is finally starting to actually fix these. I like just about everything they're doing. I mean, some simple things like, you know, changing, you know, the admin roles, giving you a simplified, set of admins to choose from instead of having, you know, what was it like 3 to 5 different options?
Yeah.
You have like 2.
Yeah. So simpler is better for sure, man.
Yeah.
Simpler is better.
It helps them build, like, you know, they retool it. They come back with 2 different types of admin roles, and then they see how that works. And then they take the feedback, kind of what Facebook's doing, take the feedback and apply it to LinkedIn to improve the platform even more. So I think it makes a lot of sense.
Awesome. Well, let's hope they do that. So, hey, so I just quickly looked on my phone here. Morgan's with us. Hey, Morgan, how you doing? Sorry, we're on
Morgan.
Zoom tonight, so we can't. I can't respond in real time. I apologize here. Lisa Monks talks about 2-step authentication with the Instagram backup codes. Thank you, Lisa. That's awesome. Great tip. Robert C. Stern says you can only send the Instagram poll to 4 people at a time. Morgan says polls for where we're going to eat later. And then says hi to Danica. Hi, Danica. We're glad you're here. And then last but not least, Morgan asks, what about group chats? Assuming you can use it there too. That's an interesting question, right? So if they're not letting us message them, maybe they will let us chat with them. I don't know though, right? Because here's the thing. There are people in groups that are third degree plus. You have to spend an in-mail to even connect with them unless you go through Google and find their profile. So I'm curious, right, how they're going to discern that. That's a really interesting question, Morgan. And it'll be curious to see what they say about that. My guess is no, just because I'm a little bit skeptical that they're, you know, that they're doing anything other than trying to push us into Microsoft CRM. But we'll see. Right? I mean, well, because, and what's interesting is they rolled out some new Sales Navigator stuff yesterday too. And the Navigator changes, interestingly, pushed into Salesforce first, Microsoft Dynamics CRM second, which is always fascinating. I would tell you that's because Salesforce has a more robust app store than Microsoft does. And it's easier to build an app on Salesforce, which is why companies can do that. But anyway, I'm curious, right? I don't know, Morgan. So to your question about group chats, fascinating question, fascinating opportunity. Let's see what happens. So thank you for that. I'm glad you asked. So, all right. So now, Christian, I'm sorry, buddy. I don't have the sound, the music here, and I don't have the graphic. But everyone, it's tool time. Yay, tool time, right? Remember that show, right, with Tim, the tool man, Taylor, and Al next door, and Wilson, the neighbor that kind of peeks over. We're here. We're kind of three tool bags talking about tools. So this is going to be kind of fun. So our first one, Christian, dude, you give me hardware, man. You give me hardware. So what is this? Are you rocking this now? Universal clip-on mini LED light. Hold on. Portable pocket spotlight for iPhone, iPad, iPod, Samsung, LG, Motorola, HTC, Nokia, cell phones, and tablets. Camera, video light, Chrome. Okay, Christian, what you got?
Yeah, Christian, your lighting is way better than mine. So yeah. Are you rocking this right now?
I actually am, yes. Let me actually... For some reason, my video keeps cutting in and out. So let me
let's see.
So basically, here's my little light here. Here we go. And this is actually pretty fantastic. Here's the thing. I you know, doing a bit of traveling, I have lighting that I love to use, but I can't really take it with me. It, you know, it's too bulky. So I'm always looking for something that can work, you know, in a pinch to be able to add some lighting. So this is basically an $18 light. Charges via micro USB, but it's an LED light. You can, you know, for instance, you can unscrew it, pretty portable, with three different settings, clips onto just about anything. Right now it's clipped onto my iPhone. You know, and as you can see here, you know, we have three different settings. So fantastic little portable light. And here's the thing. This is great, for instance, for taking selfies. But you know, for example, if you're at a conference or you're in any sort of area that has a lot of dark light, one of the challenges with taking photos or any sort of video is that a lot of these sensors in your smartphones are not very good. They're very, very, very low quality, not low quality, but it's just, you know, you need a big sensor to be able to capture, process all of that, and improve the quality of the lighting. This little portable light clips on, $18, fantastic little solution to have. It also is a nice little flashlight if you ever need, you know, a little flashlight depending on where you're at. So. Cool. That's the light. It's the Pickogen light. You can get it at socialchefs.com/PICKOGEN. We'll drop a link to all these in the comments later on.
Awesome. Yeah,
that's tool number one. And I bring this up, even though it's hardware, it's a tech tool because if I'm doing any sort of live video, whether that's Facebook Live, Instagram Live, you know, if anybody's using Periscope still, obviously YouTube Live, great little tool to have. So
will that work with my MySpace account? That's what everybody's asking. Right, what do you think? Right. No?
Hey, it'll work for anything you're doing. You know, honestly, like it doesn't matter what platform you're on.
Awesome.
You know, even if you are still using MySpace, it'll work.
Awesome. It'll I'm buying better. One for my dad's flip phone, Nick. So I'm going to, next time you go up to Krivitz, I'd like you to show him how to
use it. I'm going. I'm going to stop.
Yeah. Tell dad. Yeah. Hey, Ronnie, come here, man. I want to show you my this new device. Phil ordered it for you. I know you don't know how to use it. So that's my dad. So he's up in northern Wisconsin. And Nick just got back.
I was just there. Yeah. We were just there hanging out.
Yeah. Yeah. So thank you.
So hey, it's $18, by the way.
Yep. $17.99 with Prime.
$18. Yep. It comes in black. It comes in silver. And the battery lasts for 3 hours. Awesome. So,
and it charges by micro power USB or what?
Yeah, micro USB.
Sweet. That's cool. That's cool. Awesome. So the last tool you can use with Nick's spelunking light there, with Christian's spelunking light there. So the next one is called OneMob. And full disclosure, folks, I am an advisor for these guys because I love them that much. OneMob is absolutely one of my secret weapons for using video to get to people. It is an iPhone app and a desktop app. The coolest thing that you can do on this, check this out, is you can actually set it up so that you can record with green screen behind you, and I can put video behind me so it looks like I'm somewhere sitting live. Like, I've used the LinkedIn lobby in San Francisco that looks like people are zipping by me with OneMob, and I can build a landing page and gate it so that people have to put their email in so I can see. I have one video that I sent out that got forwarded all around the company. 14 different people saw the email. And of course, because they like the video and they like the fact that I shared documents inside of there, I shared my proposal and I shared some tips, I got the gig. So it's pretty cool. Great tip. It's $20 a month. Probably the most expensive app. Well, one of the more expensive apps. I guess we've talked about Agora Pulse, which is $7,000 in a kidney a month. But this is $20 a month. So, Nick, have you ever used this?
I have not. It sounds fantastic. So we use Camtasia for like video editing and that kind of stuff. But that's, you know, kind of high-end desktop, nothing on mobile. So I was very excited to see this when you guys sent it over. I was like, oh, this is interesting. We might actually be able to use this. $20 a month is super reasonable.
Absolutely. It's fantastic. The best part, again, it's on your mobile. So you just hold it up and shoot, man. It's a great tool. I love it. I can't say enough about it. And it's idiot proof, which means it's fail proof, which I really love, because that means that I am not going to screw this up, right? It's going to tell me, hey, doofus, turn your screen, which I really love. I think that's awesome. So that's pretty cool. I'm going to see if I can screen share it. So Christian, what about you, brother? Have you seen this?
I was checking out. I think it's a fantastic idea for an app or to be able to have access to. I think anything that can improve the video that people shoot is definitely a very useful tool.
Cool. So here we go, folks. So I'm sharing live my screen. One of the cool things that we have here, because we've got Zoom tonight, is I'm going to turn it. And you'll notice my logo is up in the upper left corner. And if you click here, I can add scripts to this. So it's like a teleprompter on my thing. I can also turn it around, which makes it really meta, right? In this case, but normally not so meta. I can whip that around. I can remove that script, right? And then I can scroll. If I had multiple ways of using my logo, I could do that. I can also lighten or darken here, so that I can hide like I'm in the dark. And again, if I'm a doofus, it says rotate the screen, idiot. Make sure portrait orientation lock is off. So that makes it pretty darn cool. Super duper simple here. So I'm gonna stop sharing my screen so that we can get back to the task at hand. But that's OneMob, O-N-E-M-O-B. I am an advisor, just full disclosure. If you wanna talk about that, Christian will provide a link, but if you really want a demo and you want to see this, contact me, reach out. Happy to help you on this. It's an amazing tool. It will help you close business, I promise.
Well, that's what I was just going to say. I mean, I love how you can throw your logo up there so easily, right? You don't have to do any post editing. I mean, you think of like just a small business, right? Let's say I'm a small business and I'm a roofing company and I'm surveying your roof and giving you a quote. Well, I can video your roof, make some notes on it, put my logo up there in 5 seconds flat and send that off. Same thing if I'm doing B2B sales, right? So I'm on the road, they need a pitch, I can talk them through it. I build that relationship with the video, but I've got my logo in there. I didn't need to send it to an editing team. I mean, that's a fantastic tool.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's super
definitely
easy.
Definitely agree.
Yeah. It's just click and go. So super easy. So two cool tools this time that we shared. We got a selfie light, a diva ring light that isn't a diva ring light. It's just super simple, three settings, 18 whole dollars, OneMob, $20 a month. And tonight, joining us was the amazing Nick Jaworski. So Nick, tell us where people can find you, where they can get more of your awesome, and how they can become even smarter thanks to you, buddy.
Thanks, Phil. Well, anyone can reach me anytime. Obviously, our website is circlesocialinc.com. You're welcome to check us out there. And if you're into addiction treatment marketing, which I'm sure a lot of you are, there is some fantastic content. Otherwise, Facebook, I'm very active on. LinkedIn, I'm very active on. You just do Facebook, Nick Jaworski, LinkedIn/Nick Jaworski. Since I got on early, because I'm an early adopter, I get my name. I don't have any weird things right after. So, yeah, anytime people reach out to me, and you can also email me at nick@circlesocialinc.com. Thanks, Phil.
Awesome, buddy. Cool. Well, that's great. So we're really glad you're here. Super, super added value, Nick. And that hat, man, that is hot, dude. We right? love that. Yeah, Nick is Branding, famous for his baby. Hat. Yeah, for
right,
sure.
Right, right. Dude, so, I've closed business off of his hat. Like, of they course. Didn't even know who I was. I walked into a room, and they're like, you're that guy that has all those great marketing videos. I know that hat.
That's it. So,
yeah, it works.
Yeah, Nick the Hat Guy. So we're so glad you're here. Christian, who's on with us next week, big dog?
So I was actually going to ask you that question.
Oh, well, you can ask
I think
me.
We're on it.
Let's pretend.
Who's okay. on next week, Phil?
Alex Abel, man. My buddy Alex from here in Tampa. He is a time traveler. He's a time traveler. Not kidding. And he's also a data storyteller for Ashley Furniture. Really great guy, so much energy. He's got a cute little baby. Maybe if we're lucky, we'll get to see the little munchkin. Wonderful wife who is going to be a doctoral student or has her getting like her thesis. She's wicked smart. I actually taught her class at USF one night, Annika. So great. They're both freaking amazing. I'm delighted that Alex is joining with us next week. But again, last words, Nick. Thanks, buddy. We really appreciate you. You brought it tonight. Thanks.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you, Nick.
Awesome stuff. So, folks, if you're listening, if you're tuned in here, you want to take a look at our website. Go to socialchefs.com. Get the emails. Go to socialchefs.com/daily to get the best of the best. Christian is writing articles like a madman. He writes the recap. You'll get that sometime Friday. He's in Bali, so it's 12 hours. So it's 11 o'clock Eastern, 11 a.m. Friday for him. So after he probably takes a nap or goes out and hunts, you know, go ride some elephants or whatever, you'll get that awesome recap. And we'll see you next week. Same time, same channel, socialchefs.com/be live. Thanks, everyone. Have an awesome, awesome week.